good news from the graveyard. He's not dead. Woo-hoo-hoo. Oh, I seek he the living among the dead. There was a resurrection, just like you said. From the dead, good news from the graveyard. He's not dead. Good news from the graveyard, good news from the tomb. What was...
All right, amen. Matthew chapter number 11. Matthew chapter number 11. He says, verse 28. One of the most popular passages of Scripture out there. He said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me. For I am meek and lowly in heart. Ye shall find rest unto your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. Father, we ask you to bless the preaching of thy book again tonight, Lord. We ask you to bless every man of God to stand and represent you. God, touch him, fill him with the touch of God and anointing of God. We plead the precious blood against all the forces of hell. And may those that need something from you tonight find it in Jesus' name. Amen. On the light side of Jesus, his yokes are easy. So if you ever want to know how to... He's going to fix your eggs. It'll be easy. All right, that's why I like mine, over easy. Amen. I want to do a simple little message for you tonight. By the time I get done, you might not say it's too simple. But he said, come unto me. That's a pretty good one, ain't it? Come unto me. Oh, I like that. Amen. Number one, you know what that is? That's a direct command. It's a direct command. God wants you to come on to Him. What are you waiting for? Right? Verse 28, I mean, it's a direct command. God said, come on to me. Come on. Come on. Right? Amen. Come on to me. That's what he's asking. That's what he's saying. That's an invitation. Right? Isaiah 1:18, come now. Let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be wool. I'll never forget being downtown with Brother Mitch Mankin. He was the best man at my wedding. And I was down there with him and it started snowing about 50 cents. A dollar size. Snowflakes, I mean huge, giant snowflakes were falling just so gently, just beautiful. I mean, it was just beautiful. And I said, man, I wish I had a verse on snow. He goes, Isaiah 1:18. I said, you're right. Come now, let us reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Boy, that was fun preaching down there like that. All that snowfall and quoting that verse. Revelation 22:17 says, the Spirit and the bride say what? Come. And let him that is athirsty come and take of the water of life. Boy, what a blessing. Yeah. There's some great invitations in the Bible. Yeah. When's the day of salvation? Yeah. Now is the accepted time. Listen, it's a direct command. He said, come. That's what he wants us to do. Invite people to come. 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 Come to Jesus. Amen. Come to the Lord. He wants to talk with you. He wants to reason with you. Come. It's a direct command. Amen. Hello. Amen. The direction is pointed. You say, what's that mean? It's pointed. It's pointed onto me. It's onto him. God's Jesus Christ trying to point you in the right direction. Yeah. Amen? Listen, people are looking for help tonight. People are looking for life. People are looking for happiness. People are looking for peace. People's looking for love. Listen, it's at Calvary. It's the Lord Jesus Christ. I mean, point to Him. He said, come on to me. He's the answer.
Amen.
Amen? I don't know if this could be any spiritual or not, but the thing is, when you line up with a golf ball, to hit a golf ball, you line up, you square yourself up, you get square, you think you're pointed to your target. Amen? 99% of the time when you hit that ball, you hit right where you was aiming. Listen, what are you aiming at? Little boy was on the outside one day and he's taking a BB gun and he's shooting towards the moon. Boom. Some old man came by and he was laughing at him. He said, what are you trying to do, son? He said, I'm trying to shoot out the moon. He goes, you'll never reach it. He said, I'm getting farther than you are. Amen. I'm getting closer than you are. Hello. Amen. Pointed in the right direction. Amen. What direction are you going? The Bible said in Colossians chapter number 3, verse 1, set your affections on things above, not on things of earth. That's a tough thing to do, is to point yourself in that right direction. Amen. I got Psalm 119 written down here, verse 133. He said, order my steps in thy word. Let not any iniquity have dominion over me. Psalm 119, 133. Amen. You need to be pointed in the right direction. You know, when I get in the Bible, I want God to point me in the right direction.
Amen.
He says in Psalm 37, verse 23, the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. Amen. Listen, I want to go the right direction. He's my compass. I like what Covey said. He said, get rid of your calendar and get a compass. The Bible's my compass. Points me to Him. Amen. Points me to due north. True way to go. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light on my path. It shows me where I'm going. Amen. I got a direction. I got to go. I'm going to Him. Just lead me to Jesus. My direction is pointed right on to Him. Amen. Ain't that good?
Yeah.
Can I give you something else about this verse? My destination is sure.
Amen.
Ain't no doubt about it where I'm going. Yeah. You said where? Be absent from the body, be present with the Lord. Amen. Listen, I know where I'm going. I'm going to Him. Amen. I'm in Him. I met Him. I'm going to Him. I'm going to live with Him forever and ever and ever. He said that where I am, ye may be also. Amen. Listen, I'm with Him. My destination's fixed. It's sure. Amen. I know exactly. He said, come on to me. That's where I'm headed. I ain't going on to some Buddha. I ain't going on to Muhammad or Allah. I'm heading straight to Jesus. Amen. Anytime I need something, it's straight to Jesus. Amen. I got a clear shot, an open line, straight into the Lord of glory. Amen. Hit my knees. Lord, there it is. I'm in. You know what He says in Ephesians chapter number 3? Ephesians 3 verse 12 said, I have access and I can go with boldness and confidence by the faith of Him. Amen. He said, if my words abide in you and you abide in me, you can ask what you will and it shall be done unto you of the Father. He said, whatsoever you're asking, my name. Listen, Jesus has hooked me up. I got the Lord. It ain't Yahshua. It ain't Yahweh. It's Jesus Christ.
Amen.
The Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And I couldn't say that except by the Holy Ghost. Amen. Amen. Listen, I appreciate that. The direction, sure, it's Jesus. You know what He is? He's the source of all my help. He's the source of all my help. Amen. Everything that I got, everything I need, amen, it comes straight just from Him.
Amen.
I got a direct line and a channel. He's in me and I'm in Him. Oh man, I'm hooked up forever. Praise God. I'm never alone. No matter how lonely I might get. Everybody in the world may drive 1,000 miles away from me and I can't get in touch with nobody. But He's right there. I got a friend that sticks closer than a brother. Amen. Amen. Listen, I come in here on Friday nights. I ain't lonely. I'm with him.
Amen.
Amen. I ain't lonely. It may bother some people, but I'm just glad I got him. Amen. I know she's got him. I don't doubt that. She loves the Lord. That's her best friend. I ain't jealous. Talk to him about him. Amen. A week ago, man, I went up. I was in bad pain. I said, Mama, you need to pray for me. I think I'm having an appendix attack or a kidney stone or something. I mean, I ain't ever felt like this before. I think I need to go to an emergency room. She just rolled out. She just began to pray. And pain left like that. I'm glad she got a divine connection. Amen. She went straight to the Lord. You know what? I've had a bunch of people say, would you give her my request? Would you give her my name to pray for me? Hey, man, I like that. She got a good friend. I'll be glad to take second seat any day in her life. Hey, amen. If she wants to sit back and say, hey, I want to pray and talk to Jesus, I'll talk to you tomorrow night. Hey, pray. Go talk to him. Spend all time with him all you want. Amen. Love on him all you want. Take your hair, rub his feet, cry on him, wash his feet. I don't care. Just spend time with Jesus. When you get done, you got time to step down and come down to the nasty now and talk a little bit. Amen. I'll fellowship with you when you get done, but spend time with Jesus. Amen. Well, I'll tell you what, that's the greatest wife you could find. Anybody out there you want to find somebody that walks and talks with Jesus. Amen. Amen. The destination, sure. Number four, he said, come on to me, didn't he? You know that speaks to me? It means there's a distance. There's a distance between you. You know what Peter did? He followed afar off. Jesus wound up going into the judgment hall. Peter followed afar off. You know what that did? That bothered me. Peter didn't fall close to the Lord. He got away from the Lord. And Peter's out there warming himself at the devil's fire. The Bible said in John 18:18, that it was cold. See, when you see the crucifixion, you don't usually ever see it cold outside. But it was cold, the Bible says. Now you think about them stripping him naked and it being cold out. When you think you need to put a coat on and a sweatshirt on and wear gloves and a mitten and a scarf, it's out there, it's cold. I think it's cold, I think it's 30 degrees. Amen?
Yeah.
I think it's pretty cold out there. And you know what the Bible says? Peter warmed himself at the devil's fire. He's over there at the fire. And Peter denied the Lord three times, just like he said. And you know what happened when he did that? The rooster crowed. Baptist preacher's been having a heyday with them roosters ever since.
Yeah.
Amen. When that rooster crowed, the cock crew, Peter heard it, and he turned, and the Lord turned and looked at him. Can you imagine Jesus standing there in the judgment hall, and you just denied me thrice, and he turns and the Lord looks at you? Could you imagine that? You just denied Jesus. You just fulfilled a prophecy that he told you. And you're standing there, and he looks over at you. And he looks at you. The Bible said Peter went out and wept bitterly. That ate his lunch. He said, you know what? I just denied my Lord. Judas betrayed him, now I denied him. Man, what a heathen. What an idiot I am. Man, you know, Peter, he probably walked out under the door.
Yeah.
He slithered. Amen. I'm telling you, you talk about feeling low. Man, he denied the Lord. You know what this speaks of? There's a distance between you and him. When he says, come on to me, if you're already right here, why would he say, come on to me if you were right there?
Right.
Pictures of distance. Let me ask you a question. What's this distance between you and God? Is there something between you and God? What's the distance there? How far? I remember down in Mississippi, said a commercial I seen on TV down there, said God seemed far away. Well, who do you think moved?
Yeah.
I freaked out. I go, wow, they got a commercial about God down here. That's something. I didn't realize I was in the Bible Belt. But that's pretty good. Does God seem far away? Well, who do you think moved? A distance. Let me ask you a question. How far are you from Him? How close are you to God? How far are you trailing? Something to think about, ain't it? You know what? Number five. He said, come unto me, all you that labor and heavy laden. I see you need discernment. Discernment is needed. You understand? Come unto me, all ye that labor and are what? Heavy laden. You need to understand what you're under. What kind of load you're trying to carry, what you're trying to take upon yourself. A man's pride will bring him low. Hello? Amen. A man's got a heavy burden on him. Amen. The weight of his sin and the weight of the wrath of God upon him. And he's trying to continually try to carry it. And the Lord said, hey, you heavy laden, come on to me. Come on. Come on. Dr. Roman draws a picture of a guy carrying a big old load on his back. And Jesus standing there in the dry, thirsty Highland Desert. Saying, come on to me. Come on. Come on. I get my yoke. Get out of your yoke. The Bible says over there in the book of Acts that they have an unbearable yoke. They get in a yoke like oxen. One place, the Bible, they make a yoke of iron. Can you imagine that, getting in that yoke of iron? Oh, man, it's just weighting you down. It's hurting you. It's not soft. Amen. A good leather yoke is soft where it helps. It don't dig into that oxen. He can get in that thing. A horse and an ox can get in that yoke, and it'll be comfortable for him to be able to pull. And they was talking about oxen the other day, and they said, you know, them old oxen, when they get out there and they get across something that they can't pull, they get on their knees. Hey, man, you get to a place, you need something, you get down on your knees and they lean into it.
Yeah.
Jesus said, get in a yoke with me. Amen. Get out of your yoke. Leave your iron yoke, your unbearable yokes, and get in my yoke.
Amen.
He said, it's easy.
Amen.
Hey, man, discernment's needed. You need to understand you're trying to pull a wagon that's not meant for you to pull. Right. Try to carry a load ain't meant for you to carry.
Amen.
Boy, I tell you what, discernment's needed. The Bible talks about a natural man. He's spiritually discerned. Let's look at this. Proverbs chapter number 9. You know, you got a danger out there. You say, what's the danger? She says, verse 1, wisdom hath builded her house. She hath hewn out her seven pillars. She hath killed her beast. She hath mingled her wine. She hath also furnished her table. She hath sent forth her maidens. She crieth upon the highest places of the city. Whoso is simple, let him turn in hither. As for him that wanteth understanding, she saith unto him, come, eat of my bread and drink of the wine which I have mingled. Forsake the foolish and live, and go in the way of understanding. He that reproveth a scorner giveth himself a shame. And he that rebuketh a wicked man giveth himself a blot. Reprove not a scorner, lest he hate thee. Rebuke a wise man, he will love thee. Give instruction unto a man, and he will yet be wiser. Unto a wise man, he will be wiser. Teach a just man, he will increase in learning. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. And the knowledge of the holy is understanding. For by me thy days shall be multiplied, and thy years of thy life shall be increased. If thou be wise, thou shalt be wise for thyself. But if thou scornest, thou alone shalt bear it. You notice there's a call, there's a voice. Wisdom's crying out. Verse 13. Another voice. A foolish woman is clamorous. She's loud, dumb, lazy. She's simple. See, she's dumb. And knoweth nothing. For she sitteth at the door of her house and on the seat in the high places of the city to call passengers who go right on their ways. Whoso is simple, let him turn in hither. As for him that wanteth understanding, she said to him, stolen waters are sweet and bread eaten in secret is pleasant. But he knoweth not the dead are there and that her guests are in the depths of hell. Two voices calling. One's wisdom, one's foolishness. One's a wise woman, one's a strange woman. Which one are you going to listen to? There's two voices out there, John chapter number 10. There's two ways. There's a way which seemeth right unto man, the ends thereof, the ways of death, and then there's God's way. John 10:1, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that entereth in not by the door into the sheepfold, but climbeth up some other way, the same as a thief and a robber. He that entereth in by the door is a shepherd of the sheep, and to him the porter openeth, and the sheep hear his voice, and he calleth his own sheep by name, and he leadeth them out. And when he putteth forth his own sheep, he goeth before them, and the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. A stranger they will not follow, but will flee from him, for they know not the voice of who? Strangers. Look at verse 27. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. I give unto them eternal life, and they shall never perish. Neither shall any man pluck them out of my hand. My Father, which gave them who?
Me.
Me. Come on to
me.
Jesus said, my Father gave them me.
Right.
You know what? I know his voice. Do you know his voice? Amen. There's discernment. Can you discern the voice of the Lord? Can you discern the voice of the Lord? Do you understand the words of God? When you hear his words preached, can you tell it? Look at John 8. John 8. This is an amazing thing. John 8, verse 47. He that's of God, what?
Heareth God's words.
Ye therefore hear them not, because you're not of God. Boy, that's a discernment.
Yeah.
They can't discern his voice. They can't discern his words. You know why? Verse 44. Ye of your father who?
The devil.
Boy, that's an amazing thing. You know what you need? You need some discernment. You know where you get discernment? Hebrews chapter 5. Hebrews chapter 5, verse 12 through 14. Talks about his words. Amen. And talks about if you're unskillful, the word of righteousness, you're a babe.
Yeah.
Amen. But he that exercises himself therein is able to discern both good and evil. You get in his book, you get in his word, you stay in fellowship with him, you know what's going to happen? You're going to begin to know his book. You'll have discernment. People don't have discernment today. They have no discretion. You know what a fair woman is? Without discretion, you know what Solomon likens her to? Huh? A gold ring and a swine snout. So is a fair woman without discretion. You ever seen a pig with a beautiful gold ring in his nose? Huh? Right? What's a pig do with his nose? Roots. Gets down in there, puts it right down in the dung, in the mire. Pulls that gold ring up, and guess what? It is nasty. Got no discretion, no discernment. That ain't what you do with a gold ring, is it?
No.
So is a fair woman without discretion. It's just like putting a gold ring in muck, mire, dog or hog squeeze. Amen. That's what it is. No discernment. Right? My sheep know my voice. Look at this. He says in Matthew 10 again, or 11, come unto me, all ye that labor, and I will give you
rest.
Isn't that good? Huh? He said, take my yoke upon you, learn of me. He said, I'm being loyal. He said, ye shall find rest on your souls. Amen. You know what? A deliverance is offered. Listen, people get help if they want it. They just don't want it. They want to go to the psychiatrist. They want to go to a psychologist. They want to go, amen, to some physician somewhere out there. Amen. They want to go to a shrink. They want to follow philosophies and man's wisdom. Listen, they're seeking the pleasures of this life. And Jesus said, come on to me. All you that labor and heavy laden, I'll give you rest. Come on, I'll deliver you. Come on, come on, come on, come on to me. Right, come on. Cast thy burden upon the Lord, the Bible said, he'll sustain thee. Amen. You know what you got to do? You got to take that burden and say, okay, here it is, Lord. And unload it. Amen. You ever carry anything real heavy? I've carried big logs, amen. And that thing weighting you down, amen. Right? And you got to finally get to the place, and you got to unload that dude. You got to chunk it.
Yeah.
You don't chunk it, it's going to land on you.
That's right.
Right? I've carried big rocks, big things, heavy things. You finally get there, you say, oh, what a relief.
Mm-hmm.
Amen. Listen, I want relief. Deliverance offered. Look what it says in 1 Samuel 22. One of the best scriptures in all the Bible. 1 Samuel 22, talking about King David. King David's going to become king in verse 1, and David therefore departed thence and escaped to the cave of Adullam. And when his brethren and all his father's house heard it, they went down thither unto him. When everyone that was in distress, 1, everyone that was in debt, 2, and everyone that was discontented, 3, gathered themselves unto him, and he became a captain over them. And they were with him about 400 men. That's what when they would just need to find people's got some trouble in their life. You know what Jesus said? Come unto me, I'll deliver you. What's your problem? Discontentment? I'll give you contentment. He said, come unto me. You in debt? I'll give you some relief. Huh? Hello? You that's in distress? I'll help you. Listen, there's a deliverance offered. People want to go try everything. Well, let me go over here. I haven't exhausted all my resources yet. What do you got to do? Go bankrupt? That's what a lot of people got to do. Huh? What do you got to do? Lose your marriage? What do you got to do? Lose your health? What do you got to do? Give you 10, 20 years in prison to wake up and say, hey? That's what usually when a bunch of guys, they've lost everything and they come into that little jail cell with their tail tucked between their legs. Some of them get so proud and cocky in there, they're going to rule the prison. You know when David Spurgeon woke up? He didn't wake up till a month after he was in prison. But then when he got to realizing he's fixing to face, he's 37 years old and realized he's going to face the next 37 years to life in prison. And he goes, you know what? I'm fixing to face the rest of my natural life in prison. On top of that, I'm going to go to hell. And man, he heard a thing that 10 years ago, he was living on borrowed time. He heard the date. It was November 30th, 1990. And on November 30th, 1980, a rival gang member blew off one of his buddy's heads with a 12-gauge shotgun. And right then, that was meant for David. And he knew I was living on borrowed time for 10 years. And in that jail cell in Montgomery County, David Spurgeon rolled out his bunk at 5:30 in the morning, knelt down, said, Lord, please save me. I don't want to go to hell. I've wasted my life. Got saved. He's been sentenced to preach by the judge. Well, I tell you what a blessing. You know what he did? He took God up on his offer. But it wasn't until he seen he lost it all. And on top of that, he's going to go to hell. I can't tell you how all that happens. I can't tell you how it works in men's hearts. But why do we got to wait until we're going to lose everything? Until we realize that there's a deliverance offered? Amen. He said, I will give you rest. You ready for this? Not only is there a deliverance offered, there's a discipline required.
Yep.
He said, what are you talking about? He said, learn of me. Learn of me. How you get to learn of him? We gave you a book. He gave you a Holy Spirit. Let me ask you a question. When's the last time you ever did a study? Look things up. Not just read it, but study it. Amen. There's all kinds of topics in this book. This book's full of all kinds of topics. When's the last time you sought God's opinion on anything in your life? That's a big, important thing, ain't it? A lot of people think they know what God wants for them, but they won't look at the book and find out what it says.
Right.
Right? The Bible says in Titus chapter 1, verse 2, He manifests His word through preaching. Yeah, man, listen. You know what? There's nothing better for you to study and read your Bible and then a preacher come in and preach on what you've been reading and studying.
Amen.
You get a question, I wonder what this means? And some preacher's got the answer. Well, I'll tell you what, that's a thrill. That's a thrill when God talks to you through the book.
Amen.
Gives you something, points you in the right direction. Listen, a discipline's required. He said, take my yoke upon you. Learn of me. The Bible says over there in Luke chapter number 10, Mary was sitting at the feet of Jesus listening to the word. Martha was cumbered about with much serving. She said, Lord, carest thou not that my sisters left me alone to serve? She said, Martha, Martha, thou art cumbered about with many things. But Mary has chose the best part, which shall not be taken away from her. She chose to sit at the feet of Jesus and learn of him. Let me ask you a question. How much do you know about Jesus? How much have you read your Bible to find out about your Lord and your Savior, if He is your Lord and your Savior? How much effort and energy you open up that book and say, Lord, would you show me something else about you today? I'm in love with you. You saved me. And Lord, I want to know more about you. I want to know more about my Lord. Lord, talk to me. Show me. Show me something in the book. Please. Please give me something good. I want to learn of you. Who knows where the Bible says something in there that Jesus learned some. Jesus said, learn of me. Where in the Bible does it say Jesus learned something? Hebrews chapter number 5. I show it to you. Look at it. You'll see that Jesus learned something. No, that's Jeremiah. I want to show you something Jesus learned. Okay? You ready? Watch this. I'm going to give you something tonight. If you read your Bible, you learn. Hebrews chapter number 5, and verse 7. Who in the days of his flesh, when he offered up prayers and supplications with what?
Strong crying.
Jesus offered up strong crying and prayer and tears unto him that was able to save him from death, and was heard in that he what? Jesus feared. But the Father heard him. Now watch this. Though he were a son, yet learned he what? Obedience. How? By the things which he suffered. Can I give you something there? There's lessons which pain brings. You know what? Jesus learned something about being a man. He's God manifest in the flesh, and he learned some things through the suffering he went through. He said, I learned obedience. The Bible said in Philippians chapter number 2 that he was obedient unto death, comma, even unto the death of the cross. He was obedient. He came to die. He came to die for man's sins. He came to die for his atonement. You know what? Jesus learned something about life. He learned something about what men go through. He learned obedience through suffering. Let me ask you a question. What are you learning about Jesus Christ? He's learning stuff about you. What have you learned about Him? Well, I know He's just a name that everybody takes. Everybody's a Christian today, and everybody reads a Bible, and everybody goes to church, and everybody's been baptized. But they don't know a thimble about the Bible. They don't know nothing about God. If he walked in a room, they wouldn't know. Do you know? I remember being down at prayer week down there, Brother Ragland's, and the minute it got on. I went and took a little break, seen the family. And it got on. And I mean, it was on, and I came back up to the path. And I mean, those men are plugged in. I mean, they're in the spirit. I mean, they're enjoying God. I mean, it's on. And I knelt down by a little well that Brother Raglan had up there, and I knelt down. And I began to crawl up there, and I got right beside that thing, and I said, God, if you'll grant me permission, would you let me come in and worship with these guys? And I'm talking, I mean, it's on. And I didn't want to disrupt what was going on, but I wanted to be part of it. And I crawled up that path to that well, and I said, God, I don't want to mess this thing up. I don't want to grieve the Spirit. And I'll never forget, Brother John Mick came up. He put his hands on me. He said, God, here's Brother Parks. And he's in a position of humility to enter in and come in with us and worship tonight. God bless Brother Parks as he enters in with us. And I got to go in there and worship with them. Listen, I was asking God for permission to go in and worship with those men. And Brother John Scott Mick came out there and laid his hands on me. He said, God, Brother Parks is in the right position. He's on his face before. Well, I tell you what, you talk about. I mean, how in the world? I mean, God Almighty in heaven's up there, and I make a petition to him. And within a minute, a man comes out, lays hands on me, and answered my request right there to enter in and worship with. How do you explain that, man? They're running around the woods, man, shouting, hanging from the trees, and man, they're in a place worshiping God. And I ask God if I can get in on it, and this guy walks out there, and he said, hey, you're in the right position, bud. Come on in and join it. I'm telling you, boy, whew. Listen, I'm talking about God doing something for you down in here.
Amen.
I like being around where he's at.
Yeah.
I like what Dan Metter said. He went over to the house where Brother Jack Wood was. And he said, "Hi, Mama," talking to Mrs. Wood. He says, "Brother Jack home?" She says, "Yeah, he's back in his office." Brother Wood just sitting in his chair, back to the door, feet propped up, looking out the window, just not saying nothing. Then walked Brother Metters and he sat down. Brother Metters was sitting there about 5 minutes, 10 minutes, all of a sudden he began to get choked up, teared up. He goes, "He's in there, ain't he, preacher?" So, "Yeah, don't you run him off either." Brother Woods was enjoying the Word of God and enjoying God. And God's presence filled his office and his house. And Brother Metters could sense that God was in there. Well, I'll tell you what, man, that's what we need. We need that discernment and then that discipline that's required to get to know God. Boy, that's what I want. Amen. Boy, I tell you, that's good. Notice next. Hey, man, I tell you, man. Whew, he said, "Come on to me." Hey, amen. Not only is a discipline required, but a descent is to be made. You know what that is? That's humility. God resisteth the proud, but he giveth grace to the humble.
Right.
Person's got to get humble. He said, "I am meek and lowly." You know what you got to do? You got to get low if you want to spend time with Jesus. I'll never forget Brother Earl Hughes preaching about the Holy Ghost. There's a lot of people think they know the Holy Ghost and about the Holy Ghost. But Earl said the Holy Ghost is like water, moving water. And he says, "You know what?" He said, "Water always takes and seeks the lowest level." You want to get to know the Holy Ghost, you got to get low. You got to seek the lowest level. Water always seeks the lowest level. Huh? But when it gets together and it multiplies, it rises. It gets a flow and it's got power. I mean, there's power in a river, but it takes the lowest level. Humility. Amen. He says in Isaiah 57 verse 15, he said, "I will revive the heart of the contrite." He said, "I'll revive the heart of the humble." You want to have revival? Humility. People argue about what kind of clothes you ought to wear. What kind of clothes a woman should wear? Huh? You ever think about that? I'll tell you what kind of clothes a woman ought to wear. She ought to be clothed with humility. How's that? Right? That's what he says. He says he giveth grace to the humble. He resisted the proud. You know what? There's got to be the descent made. You know what the Bible says over there? Condescend to men of low estate. He said, get down, get low. Everybody's trying to seek how high they can get. And what they're doing is they're stepping on everybody trying to climb up. Not willing to get low. Not willing to take the back seat. Not willing to get to the end of the line. Earl preached that years ago. He said, just get back in the end of the line. He said, just take the last place. He said, you'll be in the line. Amen. Everybody's seeking to be number one. I ain't worried about it. I'll take the back seat. I don't care. I don't care. I don't care if I get the bread. I don't care if I get the last bottle of water. I don't have to have it. That's where I want to be.
Yeah.
At the end of the line. I want to be in the back seat. I want to be in the background. I hate being stuck up here up front. I like to just blend in the background. That's where you got to be. You got to descend. A descent is to be made. Lowly. 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 He said, come unto me, all you that labor and heavy laden. I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. Learn of me, for I'm meek and lowly in heart. You know what he says? He said, ye shall find what? Rest unto your souls. You know that pictures? A delight to be enjoyed.
Amen.
Boy, Well, I tell you what, I'm glad there's great things about God and the simplicities that we can enjoy. I was talking to Coach Dwayne the other night, and he said, Clifford, I just come up here by the lake, got me a little energy drink, my little energy drink. And he said, I'm just sitting up here watching the beautiful sunset, looking at the geese coming in, landing in the water, and looking at the beautiful leaves on the trees. I mean, Coach just, he loves doing all that. There's a park that he goes through, and he took me through it on the way home from work. He comes through, and I go through this park, and it's just beautiful. And he goes through all seasons, through the spring to see the blooms, and then through the fall to see the changing of the colors, and through the winter to see the snow on the trees. He's a couple times he's gone through there, he said, Clifford, he said, snow's just packed over all these trees. It's just a winter wonderland. I mean, it's just beautiful. You know what he does? He delights himself in the things of God. Well, 2 weeks ago, we were going home, and you're just talking about that, how beautiful the sunset was, and how God just paints a sky. It's so beautiful. Listen, I've seen some things up in the clouds. People think I'm nuts. By the time I take a picture of it, it's already changed. You know how you ever see things in the clouds? I seen a cloud the other day, and it looked like somebody took a perfect cut of like the Playboy bunny. The little face with the bunny rabbit ears. It looked like he took a little cookie cutter in the clouds. There was that little bunny sitting up in the clouds. I said, you gotta be kidding me. I mean, honestly, it looked like somebody took a cut of that thing, and there's this little bunny with his ears and everything right up there in a hole in the cloud. It's like the bunny fell right through the cloud. Right? I was just, well, it looked. And then I seen a lion up there the other day, the full body of a lion stretched out. Listen, you see things in the clouds, man. You say you're nuts. I'm telling you, God shows beautiful things. And He forms them. And He lets the right shadows and the shades and different things up there. I mean, I've seen all kinds of faces in the clouds. I just wonder, I said, Lord, what is that? Who is that? I enjoy looking up and seeing what He's done. And my kids haven't got to go there yet. But I'm telling you, when I got up, go to the Philippines and we got up above the clouds. And the sun's up there and you're above the clouds. And now you're getting to see the top side. Versus the bottom side is usually black, dirty, and ugly, right? Well, on the top side, there's beautiful. Oh, my soul, man. You talk about tranquil. I mean, it's breathtaking. Then we flew over some snow-covered mountains. I don't know where I was at, man. I'm telling you, I'm looking down. I said, wow. It is beautiful. Listen, the things of God. Listen, there's a place we pulled off over here in West Virginia. Went in some place called Plum Orchard. Drove back up in there. Beautiful lake. Beautiful trees. I mean, everything. Beautiful. I mean, there's wonderful delights, simplistic delights in life. Yeah. Preacher would call me up. We'd go over there. She'd come play horseshoes. We'd pitch a few games, sit there. It'd start a fire. Sugi'd go get the kids, and they'd be coming out with marshmallows and hot dogs and just sitting out there with the preacher. Yeah. Playing his guitar, just a gentle breeze, just cool, crisp air, just enjoying the simple things of life. Boy, I tell you, amen, there's a delight in Jesus. I have great fellowship with Brother Parks every Friday night. I can't even begin to tell you. To talk to a man that's ailing and hurting, and to be able to pray with him and talk with him. We begin to pray, and the other night he began to pray, and he said, oh God, there's a herd of deer out there across the street. And he's out there in the front yard looking, and there's a herd of deer. And he began to weep and cry. And God allowed him to see a herd of deer out in front of his house. Man, I'll tell you, I mean, he's just weeping, just enjoying God. There's a delight in being saved.
Amen.
I'm telling you, some of the happiest times of my life riding around with her. We get in the car, have a cup of coffee, just fellowship. Hey, man, we used to put the kids in the back seat and they'd go to sleep. If they was awake, Priscilla would go, play a song. Play a song. We'd play the whole tape, play a song. Play it again, play it again, play a song. Huh? And then she's back there. I'll never forget, I gave her some Carl's cough drops or something. She about ate the whole bag. The whole bag of Lifesavers, yeah. I mean, just, she said simple things in life. Candy. But I'm just telling you, enjoying life, being with each other. I'm telling you, I'm just thankful. You know, I don't like my job sometimes. It's tedious. It just wears on the flesh, but I'm glad I got a job. You know what? I don't always like everything them guys say or do, but you know what? They're some of the best guys to be around. Yeah. God put me in a good place.
Hey.
Amen. Most of the time, if there's something there I don't like, you just say, hey, sucker, look in the mirror, you idiot. You're the issue. You know what I mean? Just God's been so good to me. Why do I deserve anything like that? Why do I deserve to be in a Christian shop where they don't cuss? Amen. You know, somebody might get in the flesh every now and then, but you ain't got naked pictures all over the walls. I mean, you, listen, I work in a good place.
Amen.
And how God just keeps sending it in, and the work keeps coming in. And listen, I come up with a conclusion a long time ago to help me really try to be content with my wages. You said, what's that? I said, I make more than I deserve and less than I want. I just want more. I'd be satisfied. Right? But if they gave me $5 more an hour, would I be satisfied, or I'd just find more places to spend it? You see what I'm saying? And then if I go purchase all those things I think I need, then I got to have all kinds of warranties and all kinds of guns and dogs and everything to protect everything I think I need. And all I need is Him. I got a good Bible. Right? Amen. I got a good wife. I got good children. I got good Miss Cindy. Got a good little church. What more do I need? Right? God's good to me, man. I a delight to be enjoyed. Come unto me. I enjoy the Lord. I enjoy getting along. Yeah. I don't like some of the things He says to me. I don't like some of the things I got to repent of. Hello? Listen, I don't always like the answers He gives me in prayer. Amen. Especially when He told me to drink it. Yeah, there you go. But I'm telling you, but I love Him. I enjoy being with Him. A delight to be enjoyed. I got here. You know what He'll do? He'll change your disposition. The Bible says, chasten thy son, and he shall give thee rest, and he shall be a delight unto thy soul. You know, a lot of people are fit to be tied with their children. They never properly discipline them. Listen, your children will be a blessing to you if you want them to be. A lot of people don't enjoy their kids. They're a drudgery and a trick. I've never found that to be so. I don't like everything they decide and what they want to do or whatever, but I tell you what, I love my children. I love being around them. I love hearing my kids laugh. I mean, that was some of the greatest times. I mean, they'd get the laughing in the back seat, and we'd get the laughing up front. And they had this laugh going. They'd get each other going, man. They'd start laughing. And, man, it was fun. It was just fun. You know what? It'd be a delight.
Amen.
We've had some good times playing games, had some good times. Amen. I've enjoyed my children. I've enjoyed my wife. We've had some good times. Amen. I've had good times in my life. You know, there's a disposition change. When you meet Jesus Christ, He'll change your disposition. You know what'll happen? Amen. Amen. There's a departure needed. You got to leave from where you're standing. A departure is needed.
Amen.
Wherever you're at, that distance away from God, you got to leave wherever you're at, and you got to come unto Him. There's a departure needed. Amen. A departure. You know, for some people to get saved, you know what they got to do? They got to get out of their seat. They got to get off their high horse. They got to humble themselves. They got to depart from where they're at. Turn to the Lord. Turn from and turn to. You got to come to the Lord. You got to leave where you're at. You know what the prodigal had to do? He had to get up out of the hog pen. It wasn't just enough to sit back and say, you know, how many hired brethren got, people got, servants my dad has, and, you know, I perish with hunger, they're feasting, they're eating. You know, I can just make myself a servant, but it would have done him no good if he didn't get up out of there. You know what it says? He arose, and he went on to his father. You know what? There's a departure needed. Amen. I thought I'd get all this on there, but I guess I can't. Number 11. Not only is there a departure needed, but there's a decision's got to be made. Maybe I should have put that ahead of this other one. Needs made. Got to make the right decision. You got to make the decision to come to Him. It's extended to you. You got to make the decision. You know what? With the decision to come to Jesus Christ, there's great wrestlings. The flesh says, no, sit down, stupid. You look like an idiot. No, everybody will know you got sin in your life. Hey, everybody in the church will know you're the one He's preaching to. You know what? You got to make a decision. Say, I care less what anybody thinks. I must come to the Lord. I must get right with God. You know, the day I got right with God after running from Him for 3.5 years, amen, Brother Herschel got up and preached. He said, somewhere out there, God draws a line. Amen. He said, I'll turn you over, reprobate mind. He'll harden your heart. He'll put you past feeling. I said, oh, God, I'm every one of them. And I hit the altar that morning. I wept and I cried. I sobbed. I bawled my eyes out. I mean, I could care less. All I knew is I had to get right with God. My whole life changed. You know what I had to do? I had to make a decision. February 3rd, 1985, I had to make a decision. God dealt me about preaching. You know what I had to do? I had to get up out of my seat and go down. And I told the preacher, I said, Brother Rand, God's called me to preach. So what I had to do, I had to stick my neck out. I had to make a decision. Listen, the hardest decision I made out of all that was, will you marry me? That was a tough one. Amen. Hello, there's hard decisions in life. You know what you got to do? You got to make a decision. I'm telling you, I want to make the right decision. I made a decision to follow Jesus Christ in spite of my family, in spite of her. I told her, I said, if you won't follow me, see ya. I'm going to follow Jesus Christ. Amen. That's what it's all about. I like what Brother Sandler did one day. He said, I'm done. I'm fed up. I'm leaving. He opened up the drawer. He started pulling his clothes out, sticking them in a suitcase. Amen. Mrs. Sandler. She got right up beside him, pulled the drawer out. She started getting her stuff. He said, what are you doing? She goes, you don't care? I don't care. She goes, he said, I'm leaving. I'm out of here. She said, so am I. He goes, where are you going? I'm going with you. Wherever you're going, I'm going with you. He's on a mission field. He turned around and started putting his stuff back. She started putting her stuff back. Well, I tell you what. Thank God for a good woman. Amen. Decision to be made. There's a departure that's needed, and it'll change your disposition. And then, it's a danger of delay. You know, you put it off. You may not be there. I told a guy at work named Bob. I said, Bob, I said, if I were to come to your house, or you were to come to my house and knock on my door, I said, how long would you stand there and wait on me? He said, not very long. I said, how long you think Jesus is going to stand on your door knocking? How long? You think Jesus is just going to stand outside your door and just keep waiting on you? How long do you think he'd wait? You know what everybody believes? Jesus is just a bellhop just waiting for you to ring the bell. Ding! Okay, I'm here. I'm ready to save you now. Jesus ain't no bellhop. He's the Lord of glory. He's God Almighty. Manifesting the flesh. He goes, that's time. It's time. When he says come. Because he ain't going to stay there all night. And he ain't going to stay there forever. And these people got this false notion that Jesus Christ is always going to be standing there knocking on your door just begging him, oh please, please, oh please, please, oh please, would you just please let me in your heart? I want in your heart so bad. Oh, I just want to hurt. I want to get in your life. I want your life. Oh, give me your rotten, filthy life. God doesn't want it in people's lives. He wants to give them a new life, an exchange life. He wants to take their filthy, rotten life and give them a brand new one. You don't hear preachers preaching on that, do you? There's a danger in delay. People put it off and put it off and put it off and put it off. He's the same yesterday, today, forever. Most people think he's the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. Tomorrow, when you put it off, procrastination, it becomes forever. You know how many people in hell? I bet that man, rich man in Luke 16, I bet you he said, you know, when I get a little older, I'll get saved. I get a little older, you know, I'll follow Jesus, you know, maybe if he comes by next week. You know, if you read Luke 19, Zacchaeus climbs up a tree. He said, Zacchaeus, make haste, come down, salvation come to thy house. Jesus was heading to Calvary. He wasn't coming back that way no more. He had to get in when he was there. Blind Bartimaeus sitting along the wayside begging. Alms, alms. alms. He's just shaking that little tin can, probably a little nickel in there, cling, 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 cling. A nickel, hey, need some alms. He's hearing a crowd. He says, what's all that? What's all that to do? What's going on? I hear a crowd coming by. What's happening? They say, well, Jesus is coming by. Jesus? The one that heals people? Yeah, Jesus! Shh, hush, hush. Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me! Shh, shh, Jesus! The Bible said he cried so much the more. Amen. That was the last time he's coming through, man. He needed a touch. He wanted to see. Nobody else wanted him to see. He's a blind beggar sitting on the side of the road. Dirty, disgusting, amen, defiled. Amen. Probably stuck up to high heaven. Looked like Pig Pen and Charlie Brown. There he is sitting on the side of the road. He said, Jesus! And he stopped. He said, he calleth for thee. Next thing you know, he comes up there. He said, what do you want? He said, Lord, I want to be able to receive my sight. He said, according to thy faith, be it so.
Suppose at night when you close your eyes, you take your final breath. All the years you spent here on earth, not a minute would you have left. Did you ever ask the Lord to save you? Ever get down on your knees and pray? Do you know what you're gonna hear when you face him on Judgment Day? Will he say, enter in, my good and faithful one? Or will he say, depart from me, I never knew you and the wicked things you've done? Will you enter heaven's gates or hell? Fire down below. Close your eyes for the final time. Do you know where you will go?